So, what is the idea? I will talk about why, how, and some conclusions. Okay, first we need to look around and know where we live. We live on Earth, in the surface of the Earth, the blue planet. And that's, there are no credits in the picture, sorry, but it's from Apollo 17. It's one of the most famous pictures of the Earth. But trouble, Earth is not blue. Usually, without some kind of ink, Earth is not blue. And Earth's surface is 70% water and 30% Earth. So why the hell is the planet called Earth if it is mainly water? And if we talk with someone from, for instance, from chemistry department, they say, oh, water is the most strangest molecule that one can have, and it is the substance of life. So, if we live because of water, if 70% of the planet's surface is water, we should look at water with other eyes. So, and we should have different perspectives. There's an S missing. as always, there's an S. So, one perspective is let's go explore the oceans. That's a very valid perspective for the 17th and 16th century. The correct perspective, it's let's know the place where we live. That's the perspective of the 21st century, and that's where we are. It's not an option, it's a very serious need. And then we have another thing that Manuel was talking about, robots. Well, robots are a kind of toy. Something you play, something not very serious. Trouble is, toys should be taken very seriously. Because toys, one learns a lot with toys. About the time spent with toys, the hidden curriculum of toys. Let's say, for instance, one grabs a stone from a street. That's a toy. One can learn gravity. One can learn material resistance. One can learn what is a sharp edge. That the stone is harder than our skin. So, inside a toy, there is always a great pedagogical value. And they exist physically. Today we spend a lot of time in virtual space. We spend lots of time in Facebook, in LinkedIn, in discussion groups. But robots exist physically and take us back to the physical reality. And they move. That's a very nice thing. So, building robots, in order to build a robot, one should understand physics, mechanics, design, electricity, electronics, programming, and so on. I hope no one among you would say, oh, but mechanics is a branch of physics. I'm not discussing branches or competences now. The question is, in order to really build a robot, one needs skills or knowledge in many different areas, and one can see that those skills and those knowledge have very complex interactions. For instance, the material in which chosen for building a robot arm will determine the weight of the robot arm, will determine the kind of electric engine or actuator that can move the robot arm, will have interactions with the software that should be designed to move the robot arm. So everything is interconnected like in real life. And in order to build this robot, there was cooperation between people from different areas and cultures, from Spain to Finland. That this is the EPS group that built this robot. So, this robot is biologically inspired. To some of our students, when we say biologically inspired, they think, oh, we can do copy-paste from nature. We look at what nature has done and we do some copy-paste. Well, we may look into many different ideas, but to really look is very hard work. It's very easy to look, but it is very hard to see. For instance, last week there was an article in a journal about biological behavior, about some guys that found out that really we tend to consider ants as very working animals, but they say that 1/3 of the ants on an anthill are lazy. So we are looking at the ants many years and only now we found out that. So to really look is our work. And another thing, we then must do a remix. And we have another issue, that is, one can look, for instance, at a Japanese robot and make a copy, but one can look at something that nature has done, and we cannot use the same materials. No way. We cannot build it on the same way. We cannot use the same actuators. So it's a kind of doing a remix, getting only inspiration and then our work. One of the first things that the team made was a logo. It may seem a very not very useful, but the idea is to promote team identity, to teamwork, and give them some motivation. Then they made the real thing, and the real thing has two parts. One part is the electronics, and the other part is the propulsion, the movement of the fish. For the electronics is very simple. Some Arduino, motor shield, servos, a motor for the tail and battery. The propulsion is an innovative approach because it uses a motor and an irregular shaft. As the shaft is has not a regular shape, When the motor turns, it provokes the tail undulation of the tail because the shaft is turning and it's not fixed to the tail. It flexes and it can move the tail. So the movement will depend not only on the motor speed. That is something that can be controlled after the fish is built, but also the shaft shape. One can try different variations of shaft shape in order to have different kind of different kinds of undulations of the tail. So, conclusions. There were too many constraints, but as usual, constraints are good for creativity. Only when you have constraints can you have creativity, and only when you have constraints you can have engineering. Students cooperated in the project in a correct way. That was one of the most important things. And different knowledge areas were covered because they needed to consider the buoyancy, the waterproofing, the power budget, the material choice. So very different areas were covered, and the prototype was produced and tested. And the most important thing, sustainability was considered during all the phases of the project. So, many thanks for the attention.